We welcome everyone today as we come together to Trinity Christian Fellowship. We come today to worship in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Welcome everyone. We thank you for your presence here today. We encourage you to join in our prayers and our singing and all that we do today as we worship our Lord Jesus Christ. Will you hear a call to worship? And we come in the name of the Lord, even as we have heard, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We come to serve the risen Christ. We come to be the children of God. Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be here today. We ask you to bless this time together. Bless in all that we do, that we may give honor and glory to your name. And we praise it. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Will you join with us as we sing together, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Will you join me as we go to the Lord in prayer? Our Lord Jesus Christ, our Father God, we come to you today. We come with our hearts open to receive all that you have prepared for us. Yes, Lord, even in the midst of all the crises and the things that are going on around us, we are here to receive Jesus Christ, to receive his Spirit, to allow him to touch us and allow ourselves to be used of him in whatever purpose that might be. In the midst of all of the sorrow, in the midst of the anxiety and the fear, Lord, help us to cling to the promise of Jesus Christ and know that it is God who holds us in his hands. Help us also, Lord, to know that even in this time, let us not cling so much to the world, to the sins, to the flesh in such a way that we do not recognize the forgiving power of our Lord Jesus Christ and what he has done for us. We look to him, Lord, then for forgiveness. And Lord, through the Holy Spirit, we look to him for leadership, for guidance. And we give praise to all that he leads us through. Help us, like Paul, to be thankful in all things. Yes, Lord, whether good or bad. Strengthen us then. Calm our fears. Alleviate our anxiety. Forgive our sins. And help us to trust and walk in your way. We thank you, Lord, and we pray this prayer in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
There are moments on our journey following the Lord when God illumines every step we take. Times when circumstances make perfect sense to us, and we try to understand each move he makes. When the path grows dim and your questions have no answers, turn to him. The heart of your Father when the answers go beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, turn your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of the King, bow the knee. There are days when clouds surround us and the rain begins to fall. The cold and lonely winds won't cease to blow, and there seems to be no reason for the suffering we feel. We are tempted to believe God does not know. When the storms arise, don't forget we live by faith and not by sight. Bow the knee, trust the heart of your Father when the answers go beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, turn your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of the King, bow the knee, trust the heart of your Father when the answers go beyond what you can see. Bow the knee, turn your eyes toward heaven and believe the one who holds eternity. And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of the King, bow the knee. And when you don't understand the purpose of his plan, in the presence of the King. Bow the knee, bow the knee.
Welcome. As we gather around God's Word this morning, would you join me in a word of prayer? As the rain and snow come down from heaven and do not return there without furnishing seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be, which goes forth from my mouth, will not return to me void or empty. It will not come back to me without accomplishing the purpose for which I sent it. Heavenly Father, as we open your word this morning, we pray that it would accomplish your purposes. Lord, illumine your text, illumine our hearts, help us to understand it, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning's text is taken from the Gospel of Luke, the 24th chapter. It's a passage that's probably familiar to many of you. It's the story of Jesus on the Emmaus Road with two of his disciples. It's a road trip, and it reminds me of a story I heard once about a road trip. Four college guys were going from Jacksonville, Florida to L.A. across I-10, and they were in a little car, and on the second day of the journey, these four guys, one was from Idaho, one was from Iowa, one was from Florida, and the other was from New York. And the guy from Idaho turned over in the back seat, sitting behind the driver, and the driver sees what he's doing in the rearview mirror. He unzips his bag, and he reaches in, and he takes out a potato, and he throws it out the window. The driver said, "What are you doing?" And the guy from Idaho said, "Well, there's so many of these where I come from, I'm sick of looking at them." And he threw another potato out the window. Inspired by that, the other guy in the back seat was the guy from Iowa. So he reaches over and he unzips his bag and he takes out an ear of corn and flips that out the window. Inspired by his two backseat riders, the guy from Florida opens the passenger door and pushes the guy from New York out of the car. The guys in the back seat, "What are you doing?" The guy in the front seat said, "Well, there's so many of these in Florida, I'm sick of looking at them." Apologies to John Roberts and John Corio. I was sitting in the gym at Dallas Town High School. This is when my son was the setter for the volleyball team. It was a volleyball game. They're not like football games. They're not well attended. The parents, some of them were there. A few of their siblings were there. That was about it. And as I'm watching Josh play, somebody comes into the gym and they're making a beeline straight for me. And I look at them and they're kind of familiar, but I'm not sure. And they come right up to me and start talking to me. Very clear to me, they knew me. "I'm sorry, but I don't have a clue." And so he begins to talk to me, and at some juncture in the conversation, he mentions the name of a mutual friend. And then the light came on. I didn't have sufficient context to place this guy, but when he brought up my friend's name, then I remembered that I had met him the previous year at a car wash, and so then I could engage better with him. Well, that's what's going on in our text this morning. We're looking at these two disciples on the road from Jerusalem to Emmaus, and the Lord Jesus comes upon them. Hear God's word this morning. This is Luke chapter 24, beginning at verse 13. "And that very day being Easter Sunday, that very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. And while they were talking, discussing things together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, 'What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?' And they stood still, looking sad. And then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, 'Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who doesn't know these things that have happened there in these days?' And he said to them, 'What things?' And they said to him, 'Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was to redeem Israel.' Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. And some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it, just as the women had said. But him they did not see. And he said to them, O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as if he was going to go along farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent. So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to each other, Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose at that same hour and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11, those who were with them, gathered together, saying, The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon. And then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. So Luke is painting for us this picture. There are two believers. They're walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus. Their hopes are dashed. Their dreams are ruined. All hope is gone. They believed that Jesus was the Messiah, but they were present that weekend in Jerusalem. They watched as he was brutalized, as he was tortured, crucified, dead, buried. So it was all over with. They didn't expect to meet Jesus on the road, and so that's not Jesus who's talking to us. We saw what happened to Jesus. It can't be him. They didn't have a context to understand how it's possible that it could be Jesus. And there's a humorous irony here. They're telling Jesus all about what happened to Jesus, as if Jesus doesn't know what happened to Jesus. So, beginning with Moses and the prophets, Jesus began to explain to them the things that had occurred that previous weekend. Basically, he has a Bible study. Now, these two disciples, one of them has been named, it's Cleopas. The other is probably his wife Mary. It doesn't tell us that, but Mary was present with the other Marys at the foot of the cross, and they shared a home. You'll see at the end of the passage, they shared a home together. So it's probably Cleopas and his wife Mary from Emmaus. And so Jesus starts to talk to them from Moses and all the scriptures. The Old Testament was the only inspired scripture that was available to these folks at that time. Could you, starting with Moses and the prophets, explain God's working through the Messiah to others? And if you can't, then why can't you? They didn't have a little Bible in their pocket. They didn't have a backpack with scrolls in the backpack that they could unroll and look at. The Jews back in the day memorized large portions of their scriptures. And I'm not asking you to memorize your entire Bible, although that would be a good thing to do, but I would encourage you to read your Bible. I would encourage you, if you don't know how to find in the Old Testament, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, the story of Jesus, that you attend one of the many Bible studies that we offer here at Trinity Christian Fellowship. We're shut down now. We're in the midst of a quarantine. And so this provides you with ample opportunity to study the Old Testament scriptures. When I was in high school, I didn't know the Bible real well. And so one day the Gideons came by and they were passing out Bibles. That tells you how long ago this was. They could do that at a public school. And they handed me a little green Bible and I opened it up and it was full of these and thous. And what the heck is this? It's the King James. I can't understand this. Do you have anything else? So they exchanged it for another little green Bible, and that was the Beck version, or as my friend Pat Clancy called it, the California Bible, where God is mellow and everything is casual. But it was at least understandable. And so in high school, I carried that Bible with me everywhere I went because I was trying to learn the scriptures. Sadly, my friends called me Bible Bill for my troubles. Jesus sat down with these disciples. They stopped where they were going, and beginning with Moses and the prophets, he began to unpack the Old Testament to them. In Moses, in Deuteronomy chapter 18, beginning at verse 15, Moses tells of a great prophet who will be greater than Moses. What did Moses do? He called down manna from heaven. What did Jesus do? He fed 4,000. He fed 5,000. Moses brought forth water from a stone. What did Jesus do? He offers living water to those who will place their faith and trust in him. Jesus is that messianic figure from Deuteronomy chapter 15. That's 1,500 or 1,200 years before the coming of Jesus. Psalm 22 is a retelling of the crucifixion 1,000 years before Romans were using that method of torture to kill their political enemies. And if you read Psalm 22, it describes in great detail the things that Jesus went through, and some of the things that from that psalm are what Jesus experienced literally on the cross. And then 700 years before Jesus, the prophet Isaiah told the stories of the suffering servant, and it was about a propitiatory sacrifice that this suffering servant is going to make on our behalf. 700 years before Jesus came, all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his or her own way, but the Lord has caused our iniquity to fall upon him. So how do we recognize Jesus? We recognize him first in the Scriptures, starting with the Old Testament. That's what Jesus shared with these disciples on the road back from Emmaus. The Lord, in speaking about his resurrection, could have shown the nail marks, could have shown the wound of the spear in his side, but he didn't. He began with God's word. If you want to know Jesus, then you have to find him where he can be found, and that is in the pages of the Scriptures. German theologian Karl Barth wrote a big stack of books called The Church Dogmatics. It's over 9,000 pages, almost 2.5 million words. And somebody at a conference he was speaking at once said, could you distill that a little bit for me? Could you summarize for me? One, don't have the time to read all that. Two, I don't understand all these people and all these words that you're using in your church dogmatics. To which Barth replied, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. We find Jesus in the pages of the Bible. We recognize him there. We also recognize the difference between the book and its author. A family friend of ours is the retired bishop of the Episcopal Church in South Carolina, and I was helping him do some research for one of the books that he wrote. And after he'd finished the book, he gave me a copy of the book, and he wrote a nice tribute to me in pen in the front of the book. And so I showed it to my young son, Sam, and he was less than impressed. So what? You can go to a bookstore and get that, and anybody can write anything in the front. But I showed him where in his acknowledgments he said thanks to Matt Stillman for his help in the research. And Sam saw my name in print, and oh my gosh, that was a whole different ball game. That's a real thing. Meant much, much more to him. This call on the Emmaus Road isn't only to see Jesus in the pages of the Scripture, but it's to get to know the person of Jesus, the author of the book. We have the opportunity, so when Fitz handed me his book, if I had questions about the things that he wrote about, he's right there. I can ask him. And it is the same with Jesus. He gives us his Spirit. He is present with us. As we open the Scriptures, he opens the text and he opens our heart to read it, to understand it. And so we can ask him, help me to understand what I'm reading. We can ask him, give me wisdom so that I will understand or where to find you in these Scriptures. Jesus, the person, the author, is available. It's not just the book. John Wesley, many of you are former Methodists, had his own Emmaus Road type experience. He, as he describes it, was unwillingly invited to a meeting at a Moravian church on Aldersgate Street, and unwillingly he went, and the meeting consisted of one of the elders of this Moravian church reading Luther's commentary on the Book of Romans. I know that sounds scintillating. And it was about 9:15 in the evening, and as this guy is reading Luther's section about how what God does in regeneration and the change of the human heart, Wesley said, I felt my heart strangely warmed. Not only now did I understand in my head who this Jesus is, but now I have come to a personal apprehension, a relationship with Jesus himself. Paul describes something similar in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. He says this, Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, by which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word that I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what was that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas and to the 12, and then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time. Most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. And then he appeared to James and to all of the apostles. And last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. Jesus died, he was buried, he rose according to the Scriptures. And yet, Paul says, but he appeared as a person in reality to me. So the last time I preached, I picked on the hymn, He Lives, and I said that the problem is that it's purely subjective. This week, I want to repent. There is an objective part of this gospel. The Scriptures point to Jesus. It happened in time and space. It happened in history. It happened in Jerusalem on a Passover weekend. He was buried in a certain tomb. All of those objective facts from John's gospel are all still true. But yet here, there is a subjective element that we come to know the person himself and our experience of that person himself. We understand that the events of Easter can't simply be reduced to a creed. So in our affirmation of faith, most weeks we use the Apostles' Creed, and he suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose again. That's the creed. Now, I grew up in the church. I memorized the creed by osmosis simply by sitting in the pews. I never sat down to memorize it, but hearing it week after week after week, year after year after year, I had imbibed it. I had taken it in, but I wasn't a believer. I didn't know Jesus Christ. I knew the creed, but I didn't know Jesus. And then sometime later at my conversion, on a Young Life weekend in March of 1977, I came to know the person about whom the creed speaks. There is the content, Paul says, that I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. It's where the creed got it from. They got it from Paul. But Paul's emphasis is on not on a dead letter, but on a living person. He appeared to me physically. The witness of the apostles isn't just the Scriptures. The witness of the apostles is also their own experience with the risen Lord Jesus Christ. And we're recognized this morning that one of the things we're called to understand or called to do is to come into relationship with this risen Lord, this risen person. In his resurrection, Jesus moves our faith from the past tense, the creed, what Paul shared is written in the past tense, these things have already occurred, to the present tense, where we're living in the here and now. Jesus is as available to us as he was to those disciples on the road to Emmaus. Now, I want you to notice another thing here. Jesus, on this road to Emmaus, is the one who takes the initiative. They probably didn't want company. They are licking their wounds. They are despondent. They are downhearted. They're making their way, a married couple, back to their home after everything had blown up on them. And somebody comes up and starts to talk to them. He shows up where he's least expected, and he shows up where he's most needed, and he shows up and is available all the time. We don't have to go out looking for him. He's here, and he's around. And he's available. And at the end of this passage, we see another thing. We recognize that these two travelers made time for Jesus. Jesus gave every appearance as they were coming to the town of Emmaus that he was going to go along further, and they urged him to stop and stay. They urged him to come in and be with them. Have you urged Jesus to stop? Have you urged Jesus to come in and be with you? At one of the churches I served previously, an old German Reformed church that was founded in 1763, in the little narthex that leads into the sanctuary of that church, there's a stained glass window. It's beautiful. And it's a picture of Jesus, and he's at a garden wall at a door, and he's got his hand up. He's knocking on the door, and on Jesus' side of the door, there's no door handle. If he's going to get into the garden, then somebody's going to have to open the door from the inside and let him in. And the inspiration for that is Revelation chapter 3, verse 20. Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone will come in, let me in. Anyone hears my voice and lets me in, I will come in and sup with him and he with me. I will eat with him and he with me." That we need to open the door. Jesus is there. Jesus is there knocking right now. Have you opened the door to Jesus? Have you urged Jesus to stop and to stay with you? If we don't urge him to stop and stay, then he doesn't force himself on us. He doesn't demand that we make some response to him. He was willing to continue to go on down the road and leave those disciples behind, but they urged him to stay. If we don't urge him, the implication is that he will go on without bothering us. And then finally, in this time in their home, they recognize Jesus. And it's interesting, at this meal in Emmaus, that Jesus goes from being the guest who was urged to stay to being the host and the benefactor, the one who distributes the food at the meal. Jesus is the host. This is his family meal. It's no wonder that many see the sacrament of communion here in this story. And what do we notice about the recognition of Jesus? How is it that they came to finally see him and have their eyes opened? It says in verse 32, they said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn with us while he talked with us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?" We come to recognize Jesus when we open the scriptures. It's by word. And when he broke the bread and distributed the elements, sacrament, word and sacrament, these are what Protestants historically have called the means of grace. This is the usual way that God communicates his grace, his truth to his people. He does it through his word, through the preaching of the Bible, and he does it through the sacraments. The sacrament of communion. It's a family meal that we are invited to, that Jesus is the host, and that it is union with Christ. So a means of grace is simply God's divinely appointed channels that he uses usually to reveal himself to his people. And that's the picture that we have here of these disciples on the Emmaus Road. Word and sacrament, and then their eyes were opened and they recognized Jesus. They have their own testimony of faith, of a personal relationship with Jesus. It's no longer in just the pages of the scripture. It's no longer something else, but it is their own personal knowledge and relationship. One last set of lessons to take with us as we close this passage this morning. If we want to be effective witnesses for Jesus, Jesus calls us to be his witness. He doesn't call us to be people's judges. He doesn't call us to be prosecutors and prosecute them about their lives or their lifestyles. He calls us to be witnesses. Let's look at the example of Jesus in our text. First, Jesus walked with them. He joined them in their activity. He joined them doing the thing that they were doing. Too often the church is, we opened the back door on a Sunday morning and we call that evangelism. That isn't evangelism. Evangelism is going to be with people where people are doing what people are doing. So he walked with them. And then he talked with them. He asked them, "But what is it that you're discussing?" The things that interest them are the things that should interest us. And so he enters into conversation and dialogue with them. And then thirdly, when the opportunity arose, and gently with reverence, he began to show them from the scriptures. Now we can share our testimony, but that's not where Jesus began. He didn't show the two disciples the nail holes, the wound in his side. He began with the scriptures, the word of God, word and sacrament. And then finally, he sat and he ate with them. Eating together is a sign of friendship. And so Jesus ate with these disciples. These are simple ways that we can emulate Jesus as he meets these disciples on the Emmaus Road and leads them to faith and relationship with him. Amen. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this text. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you that he revealed himself to them, and he desires to reveal himself to us. Seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened to you, ask and you shall receive. Father, we ask that if there are any in the hearing of this message that have not trusted Jesus, that they might do so, that it is as simple as A, B, and C, that they would admit their need of a Savior, that they would believe that Jesus is that Savior and that his death on the cross was for them and he took their place, and that they would commit themselves, as much as they know of themselves to as much as they know of him, commit themselves to being his disciple and following in his footsteps. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let us join together in singing Trust and Obey. Hear a benediction. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Heavenly Father and the fellowship of the sweet Holy Spirit rest and abide with you now and forevermore. Amen.